This is one of their mobile kitchens that they actually...
is that even some, what I call habitual...
beautiful Stop and Shop in the Wilton... penalty, but it was actually a tax, and that... it... what's the name of the show?
Good evening and welcome once again to the Marty Heiser Show. We have an action-packed show. You cannot believe the amount of talented, interesting, inspirational, career-building people that we have coming on the show tonight. It's going to be very, very interesting. The line, 203-438-2003. If you have any questions that come up, don't hesitate to call in. All the guests have been prepared for that. They are ready to answer any questions that you might have. Tonight we're going to start with a wonderful institution here in Danbury, because as these tough economic times continue to linger, I just saw that economic growth was a robust 0.09 in the first quarter. Jobs are still hard to come by. And there's an organization, a school in Danbury called Harris School of Business. It's right on Main Street. And it is an incredible asset to the town in that you can attend this school. You don't need to have any advanced degrees. It's good to have a high school degree or a GED. But if you're looking for a career, if you're looking for something where you can get a job right away in a growth industry, Harris School for Business is really something that you should look into. And I'm just delighted to have Heidi Lounsbury, the campus director, as well as Sharon Pereira, and you are the Director of Career Services at Harrison School for Business. So let me start with you. Okay, here I am. I'm a mother, I've got a couple kids, I got too much month at the end of the paycheck, I'm looking for another job, I don't have a lot of time to go off to a four-year college or something. Mm-hmm. What does Harris School of Business, what can they do for me?
If you're interested in the medical field, we can get you educated and get your foot in the door within a month.
Within a month?
Within a month.
And it seems like a lot of what there's a need for is certified nursing aid. Mm-hmm. That's one of the programs.
That's one.
But as well as what I guess you refer to as medical administration, mm-hmm. Record keeping, things like that. And these are places where jobs are going wanting. They're ready. You could start right away.
Right away.
Wow. Okay, so how long do you have to commit if you're going to sign up for a program? Like, what is it, a certification, a diploma? What do you get?
With the Certified Nursing Aid Program, you would get a certification from our school, and then we also are a state licensed site, and we do state testing there, so you can get your state testing done at our site as well. Uh-huh. And then you're going to have your state license, and you can get right out in the field, work with Sharon and myself, and we'll get you placed.
Okay, so Sharon, part of your job, I'm envisioning you in an office with a desk and a phone.
Yes.
And you have doctor's offices, you have assisted living institutions calling you.
Yeah.
Where are you placing? Because I understand that your placement rate is a whopping, a very robust 87%. That's pretty good.
It is.
And I think those last 13%, they're just not trying. They don't really want to. So who are calling you, and where can you place the graduates from the Harrison School of Business?
Exactly as you said, there's facilities, long-term nursing care, hospitals, urgent care. There are the labs now that are doing just blood draws. You know, it's really what the student wants to do. Mm-hmm. I mean, when they come in, I say, where do you want to work? What hours would you like? Because I have so many job orders that, you know, they get to pick.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
It's nice.
You look at unemployment, and sometimes in urban areas, it can be high. Mm-hmm. But what I hear you saying is with a little bit of initiative, and I understand that there's scholarship and state monies available too if you want to go into the school.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's interesting. There was the Ridgefield Visiting Nurses Association. I know there's some callers of this program that aren't really in favor of the Ridgefield VNA, but the Ridgefield Visiting Nurses Association, which I think they use certified nurses aides and others. Mm-hmm. They just had their big fundraising breakfast at the Amber Room. I mean, it was like packed out. Mm-hmm. But there was one nurse that really gave a heartfelt testimony about visiting seniors that are shut in, that wouldn't otherwise have their tests done, their blood drawn, their medications mm-hmm. renewed, that kind of thing. And it's really, I mean, it's like Mother Teresa type stuff. Mm-hmm. Is that what you're looking for?
We it really depends on what the student wants to do. We can mm-hmm. place a student to where they feel comfortable. Once they go through the program, they get experience in the CNA program, the Certified Nursing Aide program. They go and do 1 week clinical on-site, mm-hmm. and they get to experience that setting and decide when they go meet with Sharon what exactly they want to do. Do they want to work one-on-one in home health care? Do they want to go work in a hospital setting? Mm-hmm. And it's a great way to get your foot in the door in the medical field. If you think long term you want to become a nurse, you can start here, get your foot in the door, and continue your education.
Yeah, it starts. I mean, but mm-hmm. passing the being a registered nurse, that's a tough test, isn't mm-hmm. it?
But this gets you in the door, and you find out whether or not you like it. So yeah. A small, short program gets you into the medical field, and then you may get in there and decide, hey, this isn't for me. I'd rather do something else, but you didn't invest all that money to become a nurse if you didn't know you wanted to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So. We had a student, I just met with one today, who was a CNA through our program.
A CNA, that's Certified Nursing Aide. Okay.
Exactly, mm-hmm. And then she came back and did our medical administrative assistant. That clinical side wasn't for her. She wants to stay in the health field, but go more administrative, clerical, and that's where she is now. She's graduated both programs. Mm. She's working, and
but she's not necessarily into the, you know, all
the hands on.
She decided
it's not for everyone.
Like
so.
Yeah. All right. Now the school has anywhere between 30 and 50 students at any one time. Mm-hmm. It kind of fluctuates. Mm-hmm. What's your average student? Who do you see coming through the door, or is it quite a spectrum of people?
There is a spectrum.
It's a spectrum. I mean, we mm-hmm. have people that want to change careers and decided what they've been doing all along. They don't like it and they want to change. So mm-hmm. we have some students that are, you know, 40, 50, and then we have students right out of high school, then we have a mid-range in between. I mean, we have just a really wide variety of students at our campus.
All right, so if I'm a young lady, I'm a high school graduate, I didn't go to college, I went for some classes, it wasn't for me, I bopped around to different jobs, but I really like children, I really like babies, and I want to get into you know, pediatrics. Mm-hmm. Could you form a schedule and a career path that would make that happen? I guess I have to ask the director of career
services.
Yes, we can. When they're that specific, of course, it's a little bit more of a challenge. But there are that entry level position, which with this education, that's the entry level for the medical field.
Right.
And children need services too, so
yeah.
Definitely.
Well, it's very impressive. I Cheryl, one of the executive directors here, went through your program, and
yes.
She was so gaga about it. She wanted to make sure that we came on. Now, you have something coming up here. If we can get a close-up shot of this, that would be good. Tell me about this and what's coming up. The Marrow Donor Registry Drive.
Yes, on May 18th, we are having a bone marrow drive. It's to help that young little boy, Isaiah. Mm. And this will be our second drive for him. We're still working to help find a match for him. So we had 12 people add to the registry. No, not yet.
Uh-huh.
So hopefully.
And it's open to the public. And that means you come to the school and you can sit and they teach you about it.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to tell you about what it entails. And then if you're interested, then they will.
It's a simple mouth swab.
It's a mouth swab to see if there's a match.
Yep.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And it's May 18th.
Mm-hmm. At 10:30 a.m.
At Harris School of Business. And you're right on Main Street, 155 Main Street in downtown Danbury.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Is there a website that they can go to get more information if they're interested in a career?
Yes.
If you're sitting there, you know, running the books for a Midas muffler shop and you're like, you know what, I want some more human contact, how do they get in touch with you?
We're on the web, harrisschool.edu.
harrisschool.edu, or mm-hmm. just Google. I Google everything.
Google.
It's
mm-hmm.
unbelievable what you can get when you Google. So Harris School of Business in Danbury, another one of the great, you know, institutions in this city.
Yeah.
there still is opportunity out there.
Absolutely.
Jobs are beckoning for you.
Absolutely.
Well, listen, thank you so much for coming
Thank you.
I really appreciate it very much. You had one other thing you want to say? Go ahead.
We have a little gift for you.
Oh!
Yes.
This is exciting. Wow, the bag.
The bag.
I get to keep this?
You get
There's
to keep
goodies.
The bag. Oh, there's goodies.
This is great. We love the
goodies.
Swag.
You get, mm-hmm.
you know, we have a guy, Mike Mancini, coming on. He's a minister at Walnut Hill Community Church. I wonder if he brought me any swag. Oh my
Some
goodness!
Scrubs.
Oh, this is so cool. All right.
All right.
You can be
and
official.
And I get to keep this.
You get to keep
oh,
this.
You guys are the best. I didn't know I was going to get swag. Listen, Harris School of Business. I know it sounds like an MBA program or something like that, but it's really geared towards careers in the medical field, and the jobs are waiting for you. If you're sitting there on the couch right now, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? This is a great career. You get to help people. So Harrison School of Business, thanks again for coming in.
Thank you
for the swag. This is wonderful. We have people coming in from the National Day of Prayer. I don't think I'm getting a t-shirt from them. We'll have to wait and see. But Harrison School of Business, I did. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Stay right there. And next up, we have Mike Mancini and Jake Laursen are going to be coming in. They're going to be doing, first of all, we're going to run what I think, if you haven't seen this type of performance poetry, it's quite impressive. And so we're going to roll that, and then afterwards you're going to get a chance to meet Mike Mancini and Jake Laursen, and we're going to be talking a little bit about their testimony, a little bit about what it means to have a conversion experience, as well as the kingdom of God. So stay tuned, and let's roll the videotape.
You guys are fine, because we're off. We're going to that, so we're fine.
There is a war that is waging. This war wakes up the sleepers but leaves the pious dreaming. It's boiling under the surface, teeming from the depth of every breath. We know this war. We know this war like we know the night, unavoidable, doing and saying in the sparseness of darkness things that would be unimaginable in the light of day. This war waging isn't sound clips from distant deserts. It's actually too close to measure. Beating out of our chests, bulging behind our eyes. Our actions, the spoils of war, the prize. There is a war that is waging. And as I fight, I realize that I have yet to choose a side. That I dropped bombs on villages with my wicked ambitions, but that I fought the good fight, lifting up my petitions. My condition is broken, conflicted, convicted of crimes for which I am guilty, but still the hero calls me to fight by his side. Because the war that is waging isn't mine. It's his story wrapped up in glory, authority revealed in the victory that is coming. Heaven is coming to the earth. But for now, there is a war that is waging. And even on this day, I hear the hero raising his battle cry. And I feel as though I can no longer avoid his invitation to do the same. But my breath sputters, my tongue stutters, my body shudders, my mind cluttered, mind in the gutter, guts full of butterflies, when I realize that everyone who follows this hero dies. The hero cries out to his father, and he invites me to do the same. To proclaim your kingdom come, your will be done. Well, what about the work that I've done? I mean, what about the plans that I've made? This is my time to shine. I suppose I could say your kingdom come as long as your kingdom looks a lot like mine. Really give up my most deeply held dreams? Could I no longer live for my colleagues' esteem? Could I really walk willingly far from the success planned for me? I mean, what would this hero do if I gave him reign over my hallowed halls? Would he really expect to be my royalty, holding the authority to trade my family's great and prosperous future for the sake of the faceless hungry? Would he tear down my banners of inherited advantages and let justice roll down even if it left me in bandages? Would he stroll down my corridors and destroy every monument built to bitterness? Would he smash every mirror that reflected my grudges, smudges of resentment smeared on smiles and pleasantries? Would they all have to be destroyed? There's a war that is waging, and we all must choose on which side we fight. Our will, our kingdoms, our dreams, our rights. Or will we proclaim with all that we have that we are willing to die with our hero? The new life that he gives, live as if heaven were coming to the earth. Our hero is bringing heaven to the earth. Our lives, asymmetry, our words, soliloquy, enter our hero and every verse sings divinity. He is the epitome of the deep-rooted harmony which intertwines through the earth and slides and shines through every part of me. He is the vine and we are the branches. We free, released, unburdened are the rebuilders of ruined cities. Standing embraced, we are the ones who in grace go to the ends of the earth. We with great joy are free to feast with our enemies. We are the ones who groan with the seas and moan with the mountains, longing for the day that our hero comes again. Because when our hero comes again, all things will be made new. See, there is a war that is waging, but it is a war that our hero has won. Life has been given to all who would die with our hero. Crowned with beauty, soaked in gladness, wearing praise like a garment, we all together will enjoy all things made new. So when the hero calls for you, when you hear the hero crying out to his father, when you can no longer avoid his invitation to do the same, will you count the cost? Will you soberly proclaim, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven?
When I first heard that poem and the expression of it by Mike Mancini, I was pretty much blown away. And I said to myself, I wish I had a local television show because I'd like to get this guy on to try to figure out what the heck he was talking about. So Mike, when you talk about your kingdom come, as long as it looks a lot like my kingdom, you seem very passionate about that.
Sure.
What were you getting at? What did we just see? What was that about?
Yeah, well, I guess the whole piece was really about the moment in the Lord's Prayer where Jesus teaches his disciples to pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Mm-hmm. And in that, right, there's this reality that we see that God has a kingdom. right? That it's his kingdom that is coming, that he has a will, which means that he has a desire for, like, as well, that his kingdom and his desire are real things, and that those things aren't just things that exist in heaven, but he wants to see those things and is inviting us to be a part of his kingdom and his will coming to the earth and being revealed on the earth. So, and I think implicit in that is that if it is the kingdom of God that we are living out and the will of God that we are living out, then there are ways in which we have to stop living for our own kingdoms and the development and advancement of them. And we have to be able to reorient our will to the things that he wants rather than the things that we would want ourselves. Dallas Willard, right, says that that the first step in spiritual formation, the first step in becoming more like Jesus and living out this prayer is wanting to want different things than you want, right? And,
yeah.
and really that's what it is. It's about his will being done rather than our own.
I mean, it's so true. I sometimes I think, like, when I'm very challenged by that piece, because sometimes I think that I'm basically, you know, you say, well, I'm really living for God, but I'm pretty sure God wants me to have, like, a nice house, a couple kids, a car, a golden retriever, go on vacations during the summer, you know. And then you kind of go, well, what difference are you, you know, than what the world says is important? But hold on.
Oh.
Caller, what did you think of that poem, and what do you think of this topic?
Well, the topic, I mean, you know, if he wants to have an invisible friend in the sky, that's up to your guess. You know, I like to believe in reality.
Mm.
Now, my first question is, how did your guest pick his God? Did he use a dartboard? I mean, how did you pick that particular God? And I'll take it one step further. I'm willing to bet that your guest is an atheist. And the reason why is I'm sure that he doesn't believe in all the gods. I'm sure he doesn't believe in Thor or Poseidon or Allah. What made him pick his God? And how does he know the kingdom of heaven if it doesn't exist? Does he just make this stuff up?
Excellent question.
Great question.
Thank you.
Yeah.
What about that?
I would love to. Yeah.
He gets to the issue of reality.
Sure.
And I mean, his point is this really, well, let's take it the other side.
Yeah.
Is reality really that we're like a 42-jointed electrochemical organism that's a result of a godless cosmos that we just sort of evolved and we're here? And it's survival of the fittest, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die, and what a long, strange trip it's been.
Well,
and is that really reality? And I'll let you answer.
Yeah.
Or is there some purpose to our lives? Are we a reflection of a creator that created us and endowed us with certain unalienable rights, among those the pursuit of happiness and stuff like that? That's what our founding fathers thought. But which is it? Which is it?
Yeah.
I want to ask Jake next, but go ahead.
Yeah, that's great. I would actually really like to hear what Jake has to say about this.
What really is reality? Is reality really that the greatest accomplishment you can have is get that new Oldsmobile and have a nice vacation in Bermuda?
Well, here's the thing. I think I'd really like to address, the caller, because I think it's great, you know? It's really good questions. I also believe in reality. For me, reality is really, really important. Reality is really important to me as well. And I think that, well, there were a few parts to his question, right? One, it was like, it was either God or reality. Right, which would kind of lead me to the question, like, is reality secular? And is that something that has been proven in a scientific way? And I think that any good thinking person would say that that is a question that hasn't been answered. So his presupposition about reality being something that is without God is a faith statement, in the same way that my statement of saying that Jesus is Lord is also a faith statement. So I think we find ourselves in equal playing field in that we're both making faith statements. And the second part of that question also was, how did I pick my God? And I could say a lot about this. I'm not gonna say a lot. All I'll say is that I didn't pick him. Mm-hmm. If I was gonna pick a God, I wouldn't pick one. If I was going to choose for myself what I would believe, I would not believe Christianity. I would not believe in Jesus. If I were going to pick a religion for myself, and I had to pick a religion, I'd probably pick Buddhism. I grew up as an atheist. Both my parents are atheists. During my senior year of college, Jesus, who to my great surprise, actually is real and actually is the one true God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, eternal, he picked me. And he came after me. I didn't choose him. He chose me, and he chooses us all. And that's a reality that each of us has to interact with and engage with and make a sober decision about.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting when you look at Jesus's ministry in the New Testament. He's out among the people, the fishermen, you know, the tradesmen. He was a carpenter. And he came up to these guys and they were working on their nets. And he said to him, you know, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. And the idea was their reality was fishing, earning a living for their family. But he said, kind of the kingdom has come, follow me and I will give your life more meaning and more reality. So is the reality just, well, we catch fish and then we, you know, live for 50 years and then we die? Or is there more to life than what we're just saying?
Yeah, what do you think?
Jake, what do you think?
I think it's really complex. I love the question of like, how did you choose your God? I love it that the dominant thought process today is to pick a God. And really, I think the hidden truth behind that is that like, if we have the ability to pick from a pile of gods, then like none of them are actually a God because we get to just pick one. So like, we don't actually believe in a God. We really believe in ourselves being the ultimate authority.
It's almost like I've heard it called the salad bar approach to kind of religion.
Yeah.
You know, like, I'll take a little bit of that Buddhism. That seems pretty mellow.
Yeah.
And, maybe Mormonism. You get a couple wives, that might be good. Or it could be bad. Maybe we'll just leave that. That's like the, you know. Yeah. But I want to go with the love your fellow man. But I don't want to go with you're your brother's keeper and you're responsible for him, like the Good Samaritan. That's going to cramp my style. And so you kind of put this salad bar together and you kind of come up with it.
Yeah. The tricky part of that mess is that like in turn of doing that, you actually discredit every single religion's view and you don't give them all credit for what they all say. If they all individually said, you know, Buddhism, Christianity, Hinduism, Taoism, if they all said, hey, we're a religion and we all point to the same way, then you could actually do that. But if to take that opinion is really not in line with any of their beliefs in and of themselves, so you're really like creating a whole different belief system that doesn't line up with any of them. Not only does it not line up with Christianity, but it doesn't line up with Buddhism or any of them, Hinduism. None of them say we are a piece of this big puzzle where they all just point to one and we're all different, you know, pictures of the same mountain. Mm. None of them actually say that. Mm-hmm. So to believe that is really different. And it's not in line with any of them. So I think that's really interesting in terms of like choosing your own God, because to actually choose one, you'd have to consider each one of those. You'd have to say like, you know, consider each of those if you're actually gonna choose from all of them. Like Mike, I think our God chooses us. It's that's much more real.
Yeah, and to be fair, right, that critique that we're kind of saying right now, say, well, you know, to just choose your own God and take a little bit of this and a little bit of that, really is not a whole way to approach life and faith. But really, I think that it would be a fair critique if someone pointed at us in Christianity and said, well, you guys kind of do the same thing. And I'd have to say, oh, it's true, right? It's
yeah,
true.
Well, when you said, one of your lines that was convicting to me yeah. is, you know, I'll follow your kingdom as long as your kingdom looks a lot like my kingdom.
Right.
You know, and it's like we're sort of taking the, you know, Western culture, American consumerism and baptizing it. Well, we'll have a little Jesus on the side here to make it look good, slap a Christian fish on our car, go to church, you know, but we're really kind of pursuing the American dream. And, you know, if it puts our families in trouble because we're working so hard, or if we're, you know, ashamed of the gospel and don't want to be considered that religious guy or something like that, you know, I'm kind of crafting my own little approach here. I don't know. I think maybe that's a little bit what you're talking about.
Yeah, yeah. That that Jesus invites all people into a totally different way of being and way of life that doesn't look like any human culture, but it looks like God's kingdom, which is really different than American culture or any Asian culture, or any African culture, or any South American culture, or any of the world's cultures. It's totally unique in its
All right, you talk one of the other lines in the poem. What do you call it? A poem? It's a poem.
Yeah, it's a poem.
Piece.
It's a poem.
Everyone who follows this hero dies.
Yeah.
What's up with that?
Yeah.
And we're supposed to count the costs.
Yeah.
Well, that doesn't sound very appealing to me. If I'm going to have a religion, I'd rather focus on, you know, Cain, you might have life and have it more abundantly, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. It's
a chicken in every pot. Come follow Jesus.
It's true. Well, okay, so there's two parts to that, right? So everyone who follows this hero dies. You know, one of the things that Jesus says is that anyone who wants to save their life will lose it. And I think that what he's saying in that is that the ways in which we naturally, intuitively, in the way in which, like, our world and our cultures influence us to seek life and to find life and to define the good life, that ultimately those things don't satisfy, that none of those things actually bring life.
Yeah.
And we have to be willing to put all those on the table. Jesus says you have to put your whole picture of what you always thought the good life was on the table and be willing to change, get rid of, maybe keep. I don't know. You know, it depends on what the things are. I'm not going to say, you know, get rid of. But Jesus says, you know, basically, I have a totally different vision of the good life.
Hmm. Yeah, I heard it say once, like, it's almost like a pyramid. And in the world, you want to get to the top of the heap. You know, you want to be on the top. And then the kingdom of God, which you're making reference to, is almost like an inverted triangle. Mm. Like Jesus said, the greatest among you will be the servant to the least. Mm. Well, that doesn't look very American. That's not, you know, Amway. Mm. You want to be the top performer, not, you know, the bottom one. And it's kind of revolutionary that way.
Yeah.
Hold on one second. Mm-hmm. Caller, do you have something to add?
Marty, you keep talking about Jesus.
Yeah, we do.
The one problem that we have with Jesus is the fact that virtually nothing he did was witnessed by eyewitnesses. Mm. I mean, there's very few factual things that Jesus did that we can really prove that he did. And in the Bible, you know, after Jesus died, in the Bible it says, all the people started, they came out of their graves and they were walking around the streets of Jerusalem. You know, it's funny that never made the news. You know what I mean?
Well, actually, it's interesting. Your point, even in the Bible, it says the following. It says that if Jesus didn't rise from the dead, then we of all men are most to be pitied. Because everything that we're counting on in this life is wrong. So if you look at the historical evidence, just take one. If you look at the historical evidence for the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it's pretty compelling. You know, if you want to go to the founder of the Muslim faith, hold on.
What are you talking about?
Okay, this is what I'm talking about. If you want to go to the founder of the Muslim faith, you can go to his grave. It's Mecca and Medina. The Buddhism, there's a lovely temple in Indonesia that you can go where Buddha is buried. Something like 2.6 billion people in the world are Christians, yet there's no burial, there's no shrine to the founder of that religion. You just can't go. Because the tomb was empty, the Roman authorities, as well as the Jewish authorities at the time, were desperate to not have this guy who was claiming to be the king of the Jews, claiming that he was going to die, and 3 days later he was rise again. The Roman authorities put a Roman guard, put a seal on the tomb, and yet still the tomb was empty. And to this day, there's no place where you can go to worship or have a moment of reflection at the gravesite of the founder of Christianity. So when you ask for historical evidence and you say there is no historical evidence, you're just not accurate. But thanks for the call anyways. Closing thoughts.
Oh man, I feel like we just got started. I think to reference one, I think peculiar story is that the resurrected Jesus showed himself first to a woman, and to respond to what the caller said. Am I right? I
think. Yes, you're right.
Yeah. So it's like, Mary Magdalene. All the disciples were like, "Oh no, no!" You know. And Peter's going, "I never knew him. I didn't know him." And then the cock crows. Those guys are all running away like you know, squealing pigs. They're all afraid. It was the women. Yeah. It was a woman of the night, Mary Magdalene, that had the courage and fortitude. Yeah. Right, ladies? All right, and they went in there, and yet in that culture, the last thing you want, women were not allowed to even testify in the courts. Mm. So if you're going to put together a charade of a religion, you don't want the first witnesses to be women, especially in that culture. Yeah. Although we've evolved from there.
Exactly.
Is that what your point was?
That's part of it. That like to discredit the entire theology belief system because there's no proof. I don't know. That story has so much to it to say that why would this belief system have that in it if it was worthless? Why would the God who came to serve actually show up at like first to a woman in his resurrected body, which is like one of the pinnacle parts of the belief system? It's not so that he's a king, a better king, because a better king would actually show himself to like the person in the strongest power, and he would have authority, and he would like destroy he would have different, the power would look different.
I think you get back to what you were talking about, the kingdom of God.
Yeah, exactly.
It's totally different.
Yeah, it's totally
different. Suffer not the children to come unto me, because of such is the kingdom of God.
Yeah, and people said, in the first few centuries as the church was forming, people were saying the exact same things, you know? Mm. And that was at the peak of Roman power in the world. Yeah. And we are not having, these conversations now about Rome's power and influence. We're talking about this man, Jesus, and what he did. 2,000 years later, we're still talking about it. No one is talking about Rome. Mm-hmm. We're talking about Jesus. Mm-hmm.
It's pretty interesting. Listen, thank you so much.
Yes, thank you.
I really appreciate it. I appreciate your work. I appreciate that piece. And thank you so much for coming in. And let's do it again.
Great.
You gonna do another one of these?
Yeah, sure.
They got me doing one of these videos. I'm playing hockey. It's unbelievable. Yeah. You'll see.
That'd be great.
It's
love
coming
to
up.
Take
I think,
calls and that would
I think
be
they're
fun,
gonna
man.
Give them
That's
all.
Fun.
All right,
great.
So thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, next up, as we switch around here, I just want to talk a little bit about this program. It is Laugh Your Way to a Better Marriage. There are going to be over 500 people at Walnut Hill Community Church this Friday night. That's tomorrow night. As a matter of fact, our community group is actually going out for pizza beforehand and then going to see this guy. Mark Gnor is really, 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 really funny. Think like great comedian meets men are from Mars, women are from Venus, something like that. And they talk about the different approaches to relationships. They talk about approaches to marriage, but it's done in a really, really funny way. I mean, I've watched this guy on YouTube, and he is really funny. One little thing, he talks about a man's sex drive. I'm sorry, if there's children around, you might want to send them all. But he said, the man's sex drive is something like this. It peaks at about 18. And from 18, it starts going down, but not by very much. And then he says, and then he dies. And that's a man's sex drive. And he talks about the relationship between a man and a woman, between a husband and a wife, and what's important, that the woman wants love. She wants roses. She wants her love language. The man wants respect and a cheese sandwich so he can watch the game. It's different. Men and women are different. I don't care what the culture tells you. They're not exactly alike. And this guy, Mark Gnor, at Walnut Hill Community Church, there might be a few seats still available. Just Google Walnut Hill Community Church. It's really, really a good time. And more often than not, it's the ladies that talk about this and that want to go to these marriage seminars, and then they drag their unsuspecting husbands along. But for you husbands out there, I'm telling you, you will have a good time. And if you don't, just come talk to me and explain how you're not having a good time, but you will. It's a good time. Laugh your way to a better marriage. Mark Gnor, it's going to be at Walnut Hill Community Church. That's tomorrow night, Friday, May 1st, and then a session on Saturday morning, May 2nd. Go! Okay. Next up, so glad you're here. Did you like that? Did you like that like poem that they had? And thank you. Give me some. Okay. Missy, can you introduce your friends here and tell us everything we need to know about the National Day of Prayer, which is coming up on May 7th?
Well, I'm going to introduce my friend Adrienne Reddy, and she's going to tell you about the National Day of Prayer.
Excellent.
She's okay. Our fearless leader.
Okay.
Okay.
Got us into this.
Oh, really? She recruited you into
yes.
this? Yes. Okay. Well, what do we need to know about the National Day of Prayer? I do have some history, like Thomas Jefferson talked about it. It originally started in 1952. Is that even possible?
Well, I can say that this is our 64th year.
Okay, wait, someone do the math. Quickly.
That's our 64th year of having the National Day of Prayer. Mm-hmm. And so, first of all, my name is Adrienne Reedy, okay. and I'm the area coordinator of Fairfield County for National Day of Prayer. Mm-hmm. And so it's just a wonderful opportunity for the country to come together and to pray for our country mm-hmm. and also for the world. And so we have certain areas of concerns that we pray about. Mm-hmm. And so that's what we do.
Okay, so it's a National Day of Prayer. It's been going on for 64 years.
This will be our 64th
year. I mean, when I looked into it, I kind of Googled it and went on your website. I mean, there have been laws passed recognizing it, you know, that kind of thing. So
right.
it's a fairly organized thing.
Yeah, it's big.
Okay, and then how will it manifest itself in Ridgefield and Wilton? Those are two of the venues?
Yep.
So what will that be?
The Ridgefield event will mm-hmm. be on May 7th. Mm-hmm. From 12 noon until 1 o'clock, so just for the lunch hour. So you can just take your lunch hour and okay. come and pray. And it's going to be at the Lounsbury House, otherwise known as the Community Center, on 316 Main Street. Mm-hmm. And so we'll have a time of, it's a structured time, it's not an open okay. forum.
Uh-huh.
So it's a structured time of worship and prayer. Concerns for the town of Ridgefield and the families and schools.
And there'll be like elected officials there and things like that too?
They are coming mm-hmm. to represent the town, but not necessarily
speaking.
Is
Rudy Marconi going to be there?
Rudy Marconi will be.
Excellent.
He will be doing the governor's proclamation for the National Day of Prayer
okay.
for the state of Connecticut. So mm-hmm. he will be doing that. He will also be praying for the town of Ridgefield specifically. Which is great. We feel very honored that mm-hmm. He's going to be joining us that day with his busy schedule.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going to be a great afternoon of worship, and then there's going to be a light lunch afterwards. So we're looking to fill the ballroom at the Lounsbury House to overflow.
It's free of charge.
No, yep. Doesn't cost anything. You just come.
Is it going to be like a heavy religious service, or is this more like a civic prayer, or...
It's going to be pretty contemporary kind of service. Mm-hmm. The music will be contemporary.
There's music too.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes. And also the prayers will be done this year by Ridgefield residents.
Okay.
So people who actually live in Ridgefield will be praying for Ridgefield. So we feel really strongly about that and how that will work.
All right, now Anne, what's your involvement with the National Day of Prayer?
My involvement is, Missy and I are co-chairing the Ridgefield event. Mm-hmm. We're very excited about it because it's moving along. People are coming on board very quickly and in good numbers. And we're excited that the music, the flow of the prayer, the people who are praying are very intently involved in this and very caught up. Mm-hmm. And Lord, hear our prayer, our cry, we have a prayer, we have things on our hearts for our children, for our families, for the schools, for the town, for the first responders. I mean, the police, the fire, and the EMTs are so necessary in a town. And we're going to honor them through prayer. And prayer for the military and our veterans and our leaders, business, for the media, for different aspects. 12 different aspects will be prayed for, as well as the general town prayer by our first selectman. So we're very excited that the town is so involved and coming together to pray for our town.
There's a verse in 2 Chronicles 7:14. It says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Is that kind of a theme Bible verse that's reflected?
Absolutely.
That is
one of our scriptures.
Definitely one
for Ridgefield it is.
Because healing the land is so important. Our land has a lot going on that needs healing. There's a lot of people who are lost, they're hurting, they're caught up in all sorts of addictions, all sorts of health problems, all sorts of things going on. And Lord, hear our cry. Mm-hmm. We are people who believe in prayer and believe you will move. And we're coming together. And we're really excited about that.
Well, I'll tell you, I mean, I'm a bit of a news junkie. Mm-hmm. And when you turn on the news now, I mean, you see disrespect for authority in some of these riots going on. I mean, I know there's another side of it, you know, potential police brutality of some sort. Mm-hmm. But really, there's a breakdown in civil order, I saw, at least in what I'm seeing in various cities in the country. Also, ISIS, I mean, beheading of Christians, just Christians. You know, I mean, I know there's wars going on, but there were some refugees that got in a boat in Libya and were trying to get to Italy, and there was like 12 Christians, and they threw them overboard just because they were Christians. Mm-hmm. The Coptic Christians that were beheaded on the shores of Tripoli. You know, you see Christianity seems to be somewhat under attack, both in our country and internationally, and it does sort of drive you to your knees
Absolutely.
In prayer.
Absolutely.
You know,
I am just hoping that this would be a reminder of the importance of prayer. Uh-huh. We need to come together. The National Day of Prayer gives us an opportunity for us to deal with our local concerns, our national concerns, and also our international concerns. I mean, we are certainly in a situation where we have to be able to come together, united, to come together and pray, because it's just we are living in some very, very disturbing times. So I think
when you think that Christianity has been in some of these countries like Iraq for over 2,000 years, so I mean these are like biblical lands, some of the you know reflected in the Bible. And now it's just being completely eradicated,
right.
Just systematically destroyed. I don't know. It's a little disheartening.
Disheartening, but I think it's an opportunity for us to wake up. I mean, us as Christians to wake up. And one of the things that we are trying to do with Anne and Missy, I help with the Wilton National Day of Prayer is for the people to be able to come together on the things that are of common concern. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is a what's going on in, let's say, a Baltimore, or what's going on mm-hmm. around the world. I mean, we're all impacted by this.
Yeah.
And so if we're not able to come together and pray united,
yeah.
I just think that this is a real wake up call yeah. for all of us.
It seems like when I was looking into it, there were some high points of people calling, as far as politicians and leaders calling for prayer. Abraham Lincoln, well, it started in 1777, the first Continental Congress called for a national day of prayer and fasting. Then in mm-hmm. 1863, Abraham Lincoln mm-hmm. called for a national day of prayer, you know, in the height of the Civil
right.
War,
mm-hmm.
a time of, you know, great right. upheaval. President Truman declared a national day of prayer and signs into law an annual observance thereof. The United States Congress passed a joint resolution, and that was in 1952. On the heels of World War II, he called for that. Then Ronald Reagan, in 1988, signs into law and designates the first Thursday of May, which I guess is
mm-hmm. May 7th,
as the annual observance of the National Day of Prayer. President Reagan signed it into law in 1988. And then it was further affirmed by the president shall issue each year a proclamation designated for the first Thursday in May as a national day of prayer on which the people of the United States may turn to God in prayer and meditation at churches and groups and individuals. This law was signed by President Clinton. And it seems like it's had bipartisan support.
Right.
It seems like at difficult crisis points in our history, you know, the mm-hmm. Revolutionary War, the Civil War, World War II, and I guess Ronald Reagan when he came in. It seems like at some point we collectively, when things get so bad, you know, when things are going along smoothly,
right.
You don't have any need for God. When you turn on the TV set and they're throwing boulders at cops in Baltimore, and you turn over to the international news and you're seeing Christians being beheaded just simply for their faith, you see the breakdown in the family, you see divorce rates just rampant, you see disrespect for authority, you see basic morality, dare I say Wall Street, and the concept of you know, not just get for me, but some sense of morality. It drives you to your knees. I don't know. What are your thoughts?
Well, I think you're exactly right. And as far as it goes with, you know, world peace, which is something that, you know, I think is one of the last items that we pray for. We finish with praying for the world and for peace in the world. And I think it's a strong and powerful prayer, because if people are gathered and they're all praying that, and we're crying out to God and asking Him to move,
mm-hmm.
we know a God that can do that.
Caller, will you be joining us for the National Day of Prayer at the Lounsbury House, also known as the Community Center, in Ridgefield at 12 o'clock on May 7th?
Marty, instead of your guests getting together to pray to an invisible friend in the sky that doesn't exist,
this is the same guy.
Why don't they go out and do something for the day? Go to work in a soup kitchen, go do something. Why are you wasting your time praying to a God that doesn't exist? I mean, aren't you people old enough to start to understand that there's reality and there's fantasy? And I mean, you know, Marty, you're quoting the Bible. Have you ever sat down and read the Bible? I mean, I ain't killing nobody for working on the Sabbath. I ain't stoning the guy that lives next to me because he's gay. You know what I mean?
I do. Thank you for that. As far as stoning someone because they're gay, my Jesus was in a situation like that, as you recall, the woman caught in adultery. But my Jesus said, let he who's out sin cast the first stone, and those that were around him put down the stone, starting with the oldest. Yes, I believe in God. I don't believe that we're just an accident of a godless cosmos. I look at one DNA molecule, and the complexity and unity and beauty that's reflected in that, I say that's just not an accident. I say that there was some intelligent design and that we are a product of a creator. That's what I think. I feel like we have an eternal soul. I think as human beings, we have the ability to love, to judge beauty. We have the ability to have a relationship, a love relationship. We have the ability to produce children. And when I look into the eyes of my children, I don't think that we just evolved out of somewhere. But I believe in God, and I believe that God created what we have. So I might be living in a fantasy world, but I think it takes more faith to not believe in God and think that we just all evolved from everything. What about that? We're in the lightning round. What are your thoughts?
I just say, when I've worked with people working with the homeless, mm-hmm. and we bring Christ into it,
absolutely,
and Christ's love, and we act in the love of God, mm-hmm. not our own love, because that would be perhaps false, but in His love, through mm-hmm. His love, I've seen lives transformed mm-hmm. in front of me. Mm-hmm. I've seen people going from basically the gnashing of teeth to peace, and looking to change their lives, saying, yes, I will go to the Bridgeport Rescue Mission. Yes, my life will be changed. Mm. And I've seen it over and over. I believe in a God who loves us, who created us out of love, who designed us from before time to be sitting at this table tonight talking about this, so this gentleman could hear the good news, could say, Lord, come to me. I'm all alone. I want to know you. I want to know your love. And I pray for you that you meet him, because you will fall in love with him. And that's my prayer.
It could happen.
Dear
caller out there, you never know. The Bible says that, behold, I stand at your heart's door and knock. Jesus could be knocking at your door. And actually, the loudest speaking out against God, and it's a fantasy, and God doesn't exist, and don't you realize this is reality? I don't know. I think he protesteth a bit too much.
And also,
God could be sneaking up on you.
Can I say something to that, too? He mentioned about why are we, there. I'm always amazed when we do have our meetings. There are people who are there who have had, no hope. But when they come and they participate, all of a sudden, those people are so grateful that they had an opportunity, because a lot of the people who come to our events, like mm-hmm. ours is going to be at the Wilton Library in the Brubeck Room.
Okay.
12 o'clock.
By the way, this is the flyer. If we can get a close-up of this as we go out. Go ahead.
But a lot of the people who come, they are so grateful mm-hmm. that they're able to come, because some of these people would never step foot in a church. Mm-hmm. So we're able to come and just be there, and they're able to join us, and mm-hmm. it's been a remarkable experience for them, people who are not your churchgoers.
Thank you so much for coming in. We're up against a hard stop, as they say. National Day of Prayer, both in Wilton and in Ridgefield. Come out and pray. It'll do your heart good. As far as Christians doing good thing in the world, I think all the good stuff that goes on through Christians speaks for itself. Thanks for joining us. The Lord, hear our cry. National Day of Prayer. We'll see you out there. And see you next week when I'm not really sure what we're doing next week, but we'll come up with something good. Good night, and thanks for joining us.